Hello students, welcome to a session of respiratory disease. Today's topic of discussion is pulmonary hypertension. It is defined as an abnormal increase in pulmonary artery pressure. It may be a result of lung parenchymal or vascular disease. It may be a result of thromboembolism. It may be a result of some heart disease like left ventricle failure, or even it can be because of combination of all these three. So when we say pulmonary hypertension, it is very common practice to treat all patients of pulmonary hypertension. Most of the doctors has a habit of treating all these patients equally. They just start prescribing sildenafil or bosentan to those patients. So it's a wrong practice. Basically, we should divide every patient of pulmonary hypertension into five categories. So we'll see it on board. Categories, while differentiating patients of pulmonary hypertension, we have five categories: CAT 1, CAT 2, 3, 4, and 5. Category 1 includes pulmonary arterial hypertension. It includes idiopathic pulmonary artery hypertension, familial hypertension. Second category is pulmonary venous hypertension, that is PVH. And we can differentiate this PH from PVH by measuring pulmonary pressure and pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. So the PAP and pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. We can take a help of this PAP and pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. So in case of pulmonary artery hypertension, the PH will high and pulmonary capillary wedge pressure will be normal. And in case of pulmonary venous hypertension, PAP as well as this PCWP will be high. And the causes of pulmonary venous hypertension are diseases of left side of heart, that is, it can be a severe mitral stenosis or some diastolic dysfunction. This third category will have a high PAP, that is pulmonary artery pressure, and patient will have hypoxia, that is O2. Patient will have hypoxia, means patient is having some underlying lung diseases like ILD, COPD or chronic asthma. So those patients will be classified under category 3rd. And fourth category is weak patients of chronic thromboembolic patient. So patients who are having a chronic pulmonary embolism of more than a 3 month duration, that patient will develop pulmonary hypertension, and we can put that patient in category 5. So pulmonary thromboembolism, it should be chronic. Acute pulmonary embolism is unlikely to develop pulmonary hypertension. So it should be chronic and duration should be more than 3 months. Coming to fifth category, it includes miscellaneous causes like sarcoidosis or some chronic anemia. So the relationship between pulmonary hypertension and these diseases are not so well defined. So that's why they have been put under category 5, that is miscellaneous category. So you can put your patient in any one of this category. It can be 1, 2, 3, 4 or 5. If patient is having some heart disease like mitral stenosis, severe mitral stenosis, and if pulmonary pressure is more than 40-50, then the category should be 2. If patient is a chronic smoker, COPD, and if pressure is around 40-50 before starting sildenafil or bosentan, which will worse the hypertension or it will worse the condition of patient, so you should definitely rule out the category 3 before prescribing bosentan or sildenafil. Again, it's same thing applies to category 5 and 4. So coming to clinical features, commonest clinical symptom is exertional dyspnea, fatigue, angina pectoris, syncope. The commonest sign will be increased JVP, the RV impulse will be palpable, there will be a peripheral edema and loud P2. So all these are the signs of right ventricle failure. So there will be increased JVP, jugular venous pressure, you may palpate liver, you may get peripheral edema. If you try to auscultate right side of heart, you may get right-sided S4, or even there will be an accentuation of P2. So all these are the signs of right-sided failure. And it indicates severe pulmonary hypertension. Coming to laboratory findings, test X-ray, most of the time it will be normal. It may show enlarged central pulmonary arteries. ECG will show right-sided axis deviation and right ventricular hypertrophy. Echo will show decreased left ventricular ventricle cavity size, and it will show TRZ. Because of increased pressure on right ventricle, there will be tricuspid regurgitation, and by measuring TRZ, by measuring pressure of that TRZ, we can calculate pulmonary hypertension in 2D echo. So this TRZ is very important in quantifying pulmonary hypertension. PFTs and HRCT. If you are suspecting any obstructive diseases like COPD, you can prescribe pulmonary function test. If you are suspecting restrictive diseases like ILD, you should prescribe HRCT. And in some cases, you need to advise TSH, LFTs, hemogram, and HIV testing. So we will see the explanation of all this approach on board. So your approach starts when you are not getting any explanation for pulmonary hypertension. So the diagnosis first step will be unexplained pulmonary hypertension. The first investigation will be 2D echo. It will differentiate between cardiac and cardiac causes from non-cardiac causes. So you may get, there will be a severe mitral stenosis, you may get some left ventricular dysfunction, diastolic dysfunction, so it will give rise to cardiac cause. And in 2D echo, when there is no obvious cardiac causes, it may show dilatation of right ventricle. And you may be suspecting cor pulmonary, that is this increased right ventricular pressure because of some underlying respiratory diseases. So commonest diseases of respiratory, we can divide into whether it's obstructive type or restrictive type. If you are suspecting obstructive type, then the choice of investigation will be PFT. It will be a pulmonary function test. And if you are suspecting restrictive diseases, then you need to see inpatient for HRCT. And this HRCT will guide whether patient is having ILD. That HRCT can diagnose patient as ILD, or it can diagnose it has some chronic thromboembolic condition, or it may come normal. So we will have three ways. This is pulmonary thromboembolism, ILD, and in some patients there will be normal HRCT. And when there will be a normal HRCT, you need to prescribe all this HIV. In case of normal HRCT, you may need to advise LFT, thyroid function test, HIV test, and hemogram for chronic anemia. So even abnormal thyroid, that is hypothyroidism, can give rise to pulmonary hypertension. HIV is also known to have a close association with pulmonary hypertension, and same thing applies to chronic anemia. So you need to do this test for patient who is having normal HRCT, or HRCT may be having prominent right pulmonary artery. And here, when all reports are normal, here you can label this patient as a idiopathic pulmonary arterial hypertension. So this is idiopathic pulmonary arterial hypertension, and from here we should start a test for a vasodilator response. You need to give a nitrous oxide, you need to give some prostaglandin, or even you need to give some adenosine. So here we will have a diagnosis of idiopathic pulmonary arterial hypertension. And if you revise previous figure, you need to differentiate this idiopathic pulmonary arterial hypertension from any cardiac cause, from any pulmonary cause, or even causes like hypothyroidism, HIV, or some abnormal LFTs or chronic anemia. Then after ruling out, you can label that patient as having idiopathic pulmonary arterial hypertension. Idiopathic means we do not know any specific cause. So coming to idiopathic pulmonary arterial hypertension, it is also called as a primary pulmonary hypertension. This idiopathic pulmonary hypertension can be because of familiar abnormal genes. And here you can have a common question, MCQ question, regarding association of gene with familiar pulmonary hypertension. And mutations involving gene code type 2 bone morphogenic protein receptor, that is BMPR2. So BMPR2. So mutation in this gene BMPR2 has close association of familiar pulmonary hypertension. So this is important in view of your MCQ. Coming to a treatment of pulmonary arterial hypertension, you need to avoid exercise. When patient do exercise, there will be an increase in pulmonary hypertension and it will worsen the disease. So patient should avoid exercise. Second therapy will be diuretic therapy. Diuretic therapy will try to correct right ventricular pressure, that is right ventricular failure. And patient after diuretic therapy, patient will be benefited in view of improved exercise tolerance. Oxygen supplementation, it will decrease dyspnea and even right ventricle ischemia. Anticoagulant therapy, you should start anticoagulant therapy for all severe idiopathic arterial hypertension, and the choice of drug of choice will be warfarin. Coming to a vasodilator response, as I told you, you should check vasodilator response to patient of idiopathic pulmonary arterial hypertension, that is IPAH. So for checking vasodilator response, you need to catheterize a patient. So cardiac catheterization is necessary. So you will need to do cardiac catheterization. And through cardiac catheterization, you need to give nitrous oxide, or you need to give epoprostenol, or even in some cases adenosine. And you should check the change in pulmonary capillary pressure after giving these drugs. And so you need to give the drugs and check the response. So the patient who respond to this vasodilator test are a good candidate to give high doses of calcium channel blockers. And those patients who do not react to this test, there is no specific treatment, but you can try many other therapies like sildenafil, bosentan and prostaglandin therapies. And you should reassess this treatment within 8 weeks of therapy. If you have started sildenafil to that patient, you should check whether there is an improvement in pulmonary hypertension. So if patient is not responding to that sildenafil after 8 weeks, so there is no point in continuing that drug. So you should stop drug and you should start other drug you wish to try. And the doses of calcium channel blocker, as I told you, the dosage should not be small doses as we use in case of systemic hypertension. The doses of calcium channel blocker, that is nifedipine, should be 240 mg per day. And amlodipine should be at least 20 mg per day. Our normal or routine prescription is 5 mg BD. So it should not be that 5 mg BD. It should be at least 20 mg in 24 hours. You can try combination therapies. Sildenafil along with epoprostenol, it has shown some good effects regarding endothelin receptor antagonist, that is bosentan and ambrisentan. You should start bosentan with 62.5 mg BD. You can increase that dose to 125 mg BD. Coming to phosphodiesterase 5 inhibitors, that is sildenafil, the dose will be 20 to 80 mg 3 times a day. You should not prescribe this patient with nitrates, that is glycerol trinitrate, binitrate or mononitrate. This patient may be having some ischemic heart disease or some past history of acute coronary syndrome or stable angina. So there is very high chance of prescribing this patient with some nitrate. And when you prescribe this sildenafil to that patient, patient may develop a severe hypotension and it will be resistant to all your inotropic drug. So the first contraindication, this is again important in view of your exam as well as your clinical practice, that you should not prescribe nitrates to sildenafil, or you should not prescribe sildenafil to patients who are on nitrates. Regarding prostacyclines, we have a iloprost which can be give through inhalation with help of nebulization, but the duration of action is very short, so you need to give that iloprost every 2 hours. Regarding epoprostenol, you need to give a chronic intravenous treatment, and for this you will need to put peripheral catheter, or you need to put central catheter for longer duration. Same thing applies for treprostinil, and these IV prostacyclines have the greatest efficacy as a treatment for pulmonary artery hypertension, and you should give to those patients who have failed all other treatments. And regarding lung transplantation, patient who fail even with IV prostacycline treatment, they are the right candidate for lung transplantation. But the availability is again issue. You can give heart lung transplantation, or you can give a unilateral lung transplantation, or if available, you can prescribe bilateral lung transplantation. So this was a discussion regarding treatment of idiopathic pulmonary artery hypertension. We will see what is the specific treatment of other category pulmonary hypertension. Pulmonary hypertension associated with condition like collagen vascular disease, the treatment of this patient will be same as that of IPAH, but it is less effective. Regarding pulmonary hypertension, which is associated with congenital system to pulmonary shunts, the treatment, primary treatment should be correction of that shunt. And again, you can use all treatment what is available for IPAH. Pulmonary hypertension associated with portal hypertension, the epoprostenol is effective and the liver transplantation will improve even pulmonary vascular disease. So the treatment of lung hypertension, that is the treatment of pulmonary hypertension associated with portal hypertension, will be liver transplantation and not lung transplant. Coming to anorexin. Anorexins are drugs which reduces appetite, and these are a drug commonly prescribed for obese patient. And this is a very commonly asked MCQ, which are the drugs associated with pulmonary artery hypertension. So your answer should be anorexin. And in anorexin, the commonest drug being aminorex and fenfluramine. And the treatment for this pulmonary hypertension is not so responsive to medical treatment. Regarding pulmonary venous hypertension, that is PVH, where pulmonary capillary wedge pressure will be high as well as pulmonary artery pressure will be high. So the commonest causes are diseases of left side of heart, commonest being mitral stenosis or mitral regurgitation. So you should correct mitral stenosis by doing balloon valvoplasty. And here this you should note that the treatment that are effective in pulmonary artery hypertension may make patients with pulmonary venous hypertension worse. So this is a category second, and I told you regarding category 3, that is patients who are having underlying lung diseases and patients who are having pulmonary venous hypertension. When you prescribe vasodilator to that patient, the patient will worse rather than improving. So you should not prescribe vasodilator drugs which are used in idiopathic pulmonary artery hypertension. Coming to pulmonary hypertension associated with lung diseases, it rarely leads to increase in systolic pulmonary hypertension more than 50 mm of Hg. Patients who are in category 3, they hardly have pulmonary artery hypertension more than 50 mm of Hg. And if it is more than 50, then you should look for any other cause of PAH. And the only effective treatment for this category will be oxygen supplementation in case of chronic obstructive lung disease. And here again, you need to note that this pulmonary vasodilator will worsen gas exchange and patient will start developing more dyspnea rather than improving. Regarding interstitial lung disease, again, a pulmonary artery pressure rarely will exceed more than 40 mm of Hg, and the pulmonary vasodilators are not helpful for this disease as well. Regarding pulmonary artery hypertension associated with chronic thromboembolic PH, so the treatment will be lifelong anticoagulation, and the suitable candidate need to go for pulmonary thromboembolectomy. So the treatment will be again not pulmonary vasodilator, so it should be a surgical treatment, that is pulmonary thromboembolectomy, and you need to put those patients on lifelong anticoagulation. So this was the discussion regarding pulmonary hypertension. Thank you.